rise to welcome. Turn to your neighbor if you, testing. If you would turn to your neighbor and repeat after me, blessed are the brief.
Blessed are the brief.
For they shall be heard again.
They shall be heard again.
I will be brief on today. I want to begin by giving honor to Bryn Ellis, the president of the university, the official board of Spring Arbor University, to our praise leaders, to Brian, and to all of the great host of witnesses that have gathered here in this sacred place for this historical and momentous occasion. I'm going to try to condense the sermon on today and follow what is called the three rules of journalism, which are number one, condense, number two, condense, and number three, repeat after me, condense. So I will try to be as brief as I possibly can, as I try to put things in order for this presentation. It is my high honor to be here today and to share with you this occasion. This is my first time speaking at the chapel, and so if you see me sweating, it's because of the lights that are beaming on me from overhead. There are some things that I do want to clarify in the presentation of myself with respect to pastoring in the city of Jackson. Coming here almost 40 years ago when I was 20 years old and pioneering the work that I'm now the pastor and founder of, when we founded Christ-Centered Homes, which is celebrating its 30th anniversary as of May 1st this year, the work that we do has to do with providing residential care supports, to people that suffer from mild, moderate, severe, and profound mental retardation. And so we have been working to train direct services and work with clinical teams in providing assessments and following through with community integration supports, helping these individuals move into the community successfully and make a transition to a level of normality that the rest of us enjoy. Over a period of 30 years, I would say that we have probably hired on an average of and employed about 200 employees annually, and I personally am happy to have signed over $200 million in checks that have gone to someone other than myself. Can we say amen? So it has been a very prosperous experience. I've been pastoring for going on 40 years. I've never been on a church salary and have given my total full-time to ministry for that period of time. And it is, as for me, a testimony that God is able to sustain us when we commit our works to Him. One scripture says, commit your thoughts unto the Lord and your works shall be established. Commit your works unto the Lord and your thoughts will be established. My subject today is going to come from the 17th chapter of the book of the Acts of the Apostles, in verses number 16 through 23. I will begin reading in your hearing if you have your Bible on your tablet or on your phone. From the King James Version of the New Testament, and all the people said amen. Say amen again. I'm going to get you involved along the way. Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and the Stoics encountered him. And some said, what will this babbler say? Others, he seemeth to be a setter forth of some strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus in the resurrection. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear something new. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him I declare unto you.'" And this would be my subject on today as I hand my Bible to Brian. Thank you. And that is, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the truth for all ages and dispensations. Philosophy, you may. Thank you, Brian. Thank you for your kindness. Philosophy obviously was that which the Apostle Paul encountered when he came to a city that was completely inundated, overwhelmed, and intoxicated and inebriated with the philosophical teachings of his times. Philosophy, the logos of man and humanity, reason being the substance of philosophy, rationalism being the argument to justify reason. It was the writings of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. who made one of the most profound statements in the history of his speaking, where he stated, and I quote, "Reason is the greatest enemy that faith has. It never comes to aid spiritual things, but more frequently than not, struggles against the divine word of God, treating with contempt all that emanates from God." And then he wrote again, "Reason, devoid of the purifying power of faith, can never free itself from distortions and rationalizations." And so we are today enveloped and encapsulated, if you will, in a world that is carried away with philosophy. If we look into the history of philosophy, the father of Western philosophy is Socrates. He, in fact, though it is said he never wrote a book, was professor and mentor to a philosopher known as Plato. And it was Socrates who refused in his rise to prominence in Greek academia to honor the gods of Greece, Zeus, Hera, Poseidon, Demeter, Athena, Apollo, Artemis, Ares, Aphrodite, Hermes, Hephaestus, and Dionysius. These he rejected for the concept of monotheism, and in his belief referred always to a single God, and in his most prolific students, or with one of his most prolific students, Plato, he persuaded him to write in his Apology, "The substance of God was one." And in Plato's Apology, which he in fact wrote on behalf of his mentor Socrates, he defended this position and concept and philosophy. When called in question by the Greek tribunal, Socrates was found guilty and sentenced to death for his belief, the death penalty of Athenian law, a poison hemlock. Plato, his student friend and publisher of Socrates' works, the Apology in particular, in these particular works, he coined the phrase, "An unexamined life is not worth living." And also, he promoted Socrates' belief that the purpose of life was to grow spiritually and philosophically. He promoted the formula of life for self and human examination, entitled Elenchus, the evolution of questions, questioning and examining one's values and beliefs to no end, but the proliferation of more questions and rhetorical debate. Plato was the professor who taught Aristotle, who in turn mentored and apprenticized Alexander the Great, one of the greatest world leaders in the history of civilization, teaching Alexander in subjects such as ethics, politics, metaphysics, poetics, and prior analytics. Noteworthy, none of these particular subjects that Plato taught Alexander addressed the human condition of sin, the need for a sacrifice for sin, and the common idea of a coming redeemer. A classical historical nostalgic story which tells of the absence of God, hence redemption, in the life of history's greatest world leaders is the story of the philosopher Diogenes of Sinope, a philosopher influenced by Socratic teachings who rose to prominence in the days of Alexander the Great. He espoused indolence, laziness, torpidity, slothfulness, lethargy, the virtues of homelessness. And in a chance meeting where Alexander the Great heard of him and sought him out to hear from him, for he was fascinated at this man's philosophical bent and how it was spreading through Alexandria and the Greco-Roman world. Diogenes lived in a water cannon under a bridge. He lived a very stoic life. Alexander decided to visit him. And when he came to him and heard him speak, it is said that Alexander the Great said to Diogenes, "Anything you ask of me, I would give it thee." Diogenes looked at Alexander the Great as he stand blocking the sun and said, "I ask that you step aside, you're blocking the sun." Alexander the Great was so insulted and so humiliated, it is said that he continued his binge of drinking and ultimately died from the cirrhosis of the liver. This proves the point that there is no redemption in philosophy. This proves the point that, in fact, we look at what the scriptures speak to with respect to the Apostle Paul and him confronting philosophy. Philosophy has never brought redemption, reconciliation, and salvation to mankind. And so today, the fallout of Socratic and Platonic teachings, today the spread of ancient philosophy has become inculcated in our academic universities of higher learning and education. Subjects that now are under the influence of these ancient teachings are the teachings of, number one, agnosticism, where one must have scientific grounds for faith. Empiricism, where all knowledge must be derived from sensory experience and stimulated by the rise of experimental science. Deism, which teaches that God is an uninvolved creator and unconcerned and remains aloof from his creation. Atheism, where the disbelief in God and God's existence and doubt of religion. And finally, the new satanicism and the satanic Bible, founded in 1966, the veneration of Satan, the teachings of atheism, skepticism, materialism, Epicureanism, the inversion and subversion of Christian theology, and the spread of secular humanism, where the deification of man and his personal representation of himself as his own divinity has taken over our government and our institutions. None of these teachings are redemptive. None of these teachings are illuminating and revelatory and enlightening. None of them bring man to a place of right standing with God. The Apostle Paul, in what we have read here today, addressed these religious, philosophical, and social phenomena 2,000 years ago with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And under the influence of the power of the Holy Spirit, the absence of the Christian institutions that are available today where Catholicism stands as a great backdrop with its vast religious and political influence. 1.3 billion people claiming to be Catholics. Protestantism with its impressive numbers, its footprint spreading throughout this country and the seven continents of the earth, claiming 2.18 billion people, according to Barna's survey. Before the rise of churches, cathedrals, and Gothic spires, before the founding of the university in 1538, before the Crusades and before the Reformers, Martin Luther, John Knox, John Wesley, John Calvin, before all of these great men were ever on the scene, St. Paul stood as a single individual and under the influence of the Holy Spirit challenged the Epicureans, followers of Epicurus, who sought to find the meaning of life through pleasure and through embracing all sensory perceptions until they found peace. And those who were Stoics, who quite to the contrary, thought that you could find peace if you simply practice self-discipline and separate yourself from all evil. Paul stood with the scriptures in heart and hand and preached the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. He presented to the leaders of the world of Greek and Rome philosophies relating to the revelation of Jesus Christ. He told the crowd of academians and professors and learned individuals who were seeking answers that Jesus Christ is the answer to all of men's problems, and that the unknown God that they were looking for would be found in the person of Jesus Christ. For Paul said, "For in him we live and move and have our being." He responded to those in search of the unknown God. He declared Jesus Christ, Father in creation, Son in redemption, and the Holy Spirit in the New Testament church. He commanded in Acts 17 and 30 that all men repent and reject the ignorance that was enveloping the philosophical world. St. Paul stands as one of the most educated personalities in New Testament church history, and unflinchingly one that challenged those in his day that are much like what we are confronted with today in the secular progressive universe in which we operate as Christians. St. Paul, the individual that God ordained to be the apostle to the Gentiles. St. Paul, the man who in his early days bound Christians who called on the name of Jesus, taking them and putting them in prison, giving his voice against them in the Judean court and sentencing them to death. Now he is one of those very people that he criticized and sought to shut the mouth of. What are you saying today, Bishop Combs? I am saying that we're challenged today with the battle and the fight against philosophy and the teachings that have proliferated for over 2,000 years. I am saying that as Christians, young, middle-aged, and old, we should take a position on the Word of God and the Scriptures and be willing to fight for what we believe. We have to be willing to push back, and we have to draw a line in the sand. At some point in time, after we leave the college and university and embark upon our careers and our positions, we will be confronted with making decisions that will challenge our faith and our Christian culture. And I urge you today to stand as Paul stood. Stand on the Word of God. Stand on your convictions. Stand on your beliefs. Do not allow anyone to turn you away from your experience with God. Continue to sing the songs of praise that you sang today. Continue to lift your hands and give glory to God. And though persecutions are breaking out all over the world, in China where Xi Jinping is tearing down churches and driving Christians out of the land, in Zimbabwe and Kenya where I was bishop, where Al-Qaeda and Muslims are raiding churches, and killing Christians who cannot quote Allah's scriptures from the Quran and cannot recite things that are important to those who embrace Islam. These things may spread in this country one day, but I urge the students here not to be ignorant and not to be vain and not to pretend that this will not affect us one day. And if it does affect us, we need to stand on the word of God. Stand. The Holy Spirit will always give power and give strength to the believer. Stand. For Dr. King said, if a man have not found something to die for, he's not fit to live. Stand with the attitude, for God I live and for God I die. Stand and do not allow these particular things that are closing in on Christians to discourage you. I urge you, God's grace will be sufficient. I urge you, God's word will hold you in place. And in the end, we will all stand before God. For those of us that stand on the word of God and those of us that embrace the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ and hear him say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many. God bless you. God love you. Embrace the gospel. Love the gospel. Preach the gospel. Teach the gospel. Live the gospel. And in the end, we shall see his face in peace. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. Let us all rise for a moment of prayer. Bless you.
Living and active and moving around us and in us. You call us, even through Spring Arbor University, you call us to be critical participants, critical thinkers in this world. And as you have reminded us of that through Bishop Combs' message, would you help us? Help us have insight according to your spirit, according to your word, that we may be people who bring your kingdom to this world, that we will make a difference for you. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.